Hello, I'm Kirsty Young, and this is a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For rights reasons, we've had to shorten the music. The programme was originally broadcast in 1976, and the presenter was Roy Plumley.
Our castaway this week is one of our most distinguished novelists, Anthony Pearl. Mr. Pearl, could you adjust yourself to a long spell of loneliness?
Well, I don't mind being alone as such. I don't think I'd like to settle down for the rest of my life never seeing anybody, but I don't mind being alone for comparatively long periods.
Are you an optimistic person?
Not at all, no, deeply pessimistic.
What would you be happiest to have got away from?
That's very difficult. I think general rush and noise and people and, above all, lack of discipline, I think.
Does music play a big part in your life?
No, not an enormous part.
What was your plan for selecting 8 records?
Well, I think chiefly, if I were on a desert island, I think nostalgia. I think that one would like to be reminded of one's past life, and I think that probably affected me most in choosing the records I have chosen.
Where did you start?
If You Were the Only Girl in the World, which I suppose I heard when I was about 10, I should think. One of the very early reviews I went to. Not the first.
And the name of the show was
The Bing Boys Are Here.
That's right. And it was sung by
George Robey and Violet Lorraine.
George Robey and Violet Lorraine. What's your second record?
Where I Laid on Greenland's Coast from The Beggar's Opera, which I suppose I saw when I was about 14 or 15, and I think must have seen at least 3 times. The whole show made a deep impression on me. It had the wonderful Lovett Fraser decor, which Lovett Fraser, his art was so immediately pillaged that, of course, it now seems rather cheap, but I think it was very original. And there were many wonderful tunes in The Beggar's Opera, but I think this particular one had an extraordinarily emotional, not to say erotic, bearing when one was young.
Greenland's coast, and in my arms embraced my lass, warm amid the eternal frost, too soon the his night would pass.
When I saw on Indian soil, soon as the burning day was cold, I could mark a sultry toil, when on my charmer's breast we hold.
I would love you all the day.
Where I Laid on Greenland's Coast from The Beggar's Opera, and in that case, the Polly and Mac Heath were Elsie Morrison and John Cameron. Mr. Pearl, you're from a Welsh border family and the son of a regular soldier, and you were at Eton and Balliol College, Oxford. During those formative years, had you already started to write?
No, I don't think I really began to write at all, apart from a certain amount of undergraduate journalism, until I came to London. And then I began at least one ineffective novel, but I don't think got more onto more than a few pages. But in round about the early part of 1929, I started a novel and then really wrote that straight off, which appeared in 1931, it's a novel called Afternoon Men.
And it was an outstanding first novel. What were you doing at that time? What job did you take when you came
back? Well, I worked in a publisher's office. I used to clean the ink pots out and compose the ads and that sort of thing.
You had a spell writing film scripts.
Well, I did, yes, but every young man who'd produced a reasonably successful novel in those days aspired to be in films. And I, for a very unhappy 6 months, I did write film scripts. And then I went to America, hoping to get a job there, and was in Hollywood for 2 or 3 months, but failed to get a job.
Are any of the British films that you wrote still extant? Do any
I don't think a syllable of mine ever appeared in the celluloid at all.
Were you writing in the British equivalent of writer's row? I mean, were you a sort of a salaried employee?
Yes, I was indeed. In fact, I think many convicts are better treated. one was expected, one was on the mat if you arrived later than 10:05 in the morning or left earlier than 5 to 6 in the evening. And you were expected to work all Saturday afternoon too, though occasionally you were not forced to.
Mm-hmm.
I would infinitely rather be in the army.
Well, you soon were, because the war started.
Yes.
You joined the Welsh Regiment and afterwards the Intelligence Corps. Did you have any opportunity for writing while in uniform?
No, not at all. I never had a moment to myself to do anything of the sort. But I did read a certain amount of tremendously heavy books for the biography of John Aubrey, the 17th century antiquary, which I had planned. And I read all sorts of books when I was on leave, or sometimes in the evening, which I think would have been very heavy going if one had been in any other circumstances. They were a tremendous relief, if you were in the army, to suddenly retire to the 17th century.
And you wrote that book about Aubrey when you were eventually out of uniform.
When I was demobilised, I sat down, worked extremely hard, and managed to get it out by 1948, I think.
Mm-hmm. Let's have your third record. What's that to be?
That is Rigoletto, which I thought would be rather corrective to the view of love expressed in If You Were the Only Girl in the World and Where I Laid on Greenland's Coast. And, of course, also it does represent old-fashioned opera, which I rather enjoy, too.
And this is going to be Woman is Fickle.
That's it, yes. I think it's hard to deny that view, don't you?
La Donna Remobile, sung by Luciano Pavarotti. Now, the war was over. You had written your book about Aubrey. Did you take a job? Because I know that for most of your working life as a writer, you've liked to have a steady job in the background.
Yes, I was on the TLS for a time, and I did a lot of other reviewing.
Times Literary Supplement.
Times Literary Supplement, yes. And various other reviewing jobs I did.
Yes, you worked for Punch for a while.
I was literary editor of Punch for some years, indeed for about 6 years, I think.
Now, you decided not to go back to writing novels, but to write a novel.
Yes.
Now, did you have a clear idea of just how many volumes this novel was going to take?
No, I knew it was going to take a great many, but I didn't really know how many until I really got within sight of the war, and I knew that I would want to write at least 3 volumes about the war.
Which years does the sequence cover?
Well, I suppose that it really begins when the narrator is about 7 or 8 and takes him on until he's about well, in his late 60s. That is about the spread of it. But the first one came out in 1951, and the last one appeared in 1975, last year.
You called the work The Music of Time. Now, there's an echo of Proust in that title, although neither your intention nor your style owes anything to Proust.
Yes, well, I would quite agree about that. It is simply a chance that there is this picture by Poussin, which is called A Dance to the Music of Time, which did seem to me to cover very much what I was going to write about. And it shows the seasons dancing to time, who is playing while they dance. And it was really purely a chance, which I never thought about at all, that the title resembled Proust in any way.
Each book is quite separate. It can be read on its own.
It can, although, of course, preferably, I like to think of it as a long novel. And, of course, it does all link together.
Now, in that vast work, there are hundreds of characters. Do you think visually, do you know what all the characters look like?
Well, yes, I think I do, really. I think I do see them visually. And I always remember my old friend Constant Lambert saying he always liked characters to be described. He liked saying he is a middle-aged man with a chestnut moustache. He then felt that he knew what the character looked like.
Well, the work turned out to be 12 volumes long. It virtually does finish last year, wasn't it?
That was it, yes.
Its conclusion must have left a great hole in your life, 25 years' work.
Well, it hasn't really, you know, because one's always interested in the book that one is writing at the moment. And I'm now writing these memoirs, and I really find I'm interested in them. And I've put the novel entirely behind me.
Now, you also published two plays, The Garden God and The Rest I'll Whistle, which have never been staged.
No, both were quite near being staged, and both, the last moment, failed to make it.
Did this leave a kind of disappointed feeling?
Not in the least, because I made up my mind when I wrote them that I would have all the fun I could out of them, and I was slightly stuck at the moment in writing novels, and of course it's a totally different technique, and I found it was a wonderful purge to turn to this other form of writing, and it didn't really worry me at all.
Record number 4, what's that?
That is Tales from the Vienna Woods.
Why?
Do you remember Vienna, which I've always enjoyed whenever I've been there very much? And of course all this wonderful fantasy life of the old sort of pre-war Viennese life. I think that would chow one up, one's solitariness.
Tales from the Vienna Woods, Willy Boskowski conducting the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra. Now, you mentioned that you were writing some memoirs, an autobiographical sequence, to keep the ball rolling. Now, your 12 volumes of The Music of Time is told in the first person by a character named Nicholas Jenkins, who's a writer who went to Eton and Oxford, who served in the war as a liaison officer. To a considerable extent, hasn't your autobiography already been written in the novel sequence?
Well, I like to think that it hasn't, because I think there are certain things you can say in a novel which I don't think you really can say in autobiography. I think that everybody approaches autobiography in a different way, and I feel very much that there are certain things which I can only express by way of a novel, and I can only hope that people will not feel there's a severe duplication. But, of course, I don't think it's for me to say. I think it's for the reader to say.
The first volume of To Keep the Ball Rolling takes you to the age of 20. How many volumes will there be?
Well, again, I don't really quite know yet. I will have to decide as I write them. And, of course, it also depends how long I'm spared. I may not... one doesn't know if I write another 20 volumes. Clearly, I shall have to be very old to do it.
You're going to stay with the autobiography, with the memoirs. You're not likely to be sidetracked by novels.
I don't think so, no. I don't think so. I think that'd be very unlikely.
You live in the country nowadays. You no longer have one of those steady jobs with magazines.
No, I live in the country. I still do some steady reviewing. I do fairly a couple of rather tough books a month for reviewing for the Daily Telegraph.
How do you like to work? Do you start every morning at the same time?
Oh, yes, about 9:30, work till lunchtime.
You work very slowly and carefully, don't you?
Yes, I do endless copies on the typewriter.
A great deal of revision.
Yes.
I think we've got now to record number 5. What's that?
It's Borodin's Polovts and Dances from Prince Igor. Insofar that I have any tastes in music, I always like Russian music very much. And I think the Polovts and Dances are very characteristic. I rather like this feeling of Central Asia and the sort of dry steppe and so on. I think it's brought across very, very well.
The Polovtsian Dances from Borodin's Prince Igor, the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra conducted by Herbert von Karajan. Let's go straight into the next record. What's that?
That's Constant Lambert's Rio Grande.
You said that he was a friend of yours.
Yes, he was a very old friend of mine. And, of course, also I knew the Sitwells well, and it is a poem by Sashi Sitwell from the 13th Caesar, and it very much brings back that particular period of my life. And I think on the island, it'd be very pleasant to contemplate the 20s by way of that.
Constant Lambert conducting the Halle Orchestra in the opening of his own The Rio Grande. This desert island dilemma, in a practical sense, how well could you cope?
I think St. Francis preached to the birds who brought him food, and he, I think my only hope would be to talk about the novel to the monkeys in hopes that they might bring me coconuts or something.
Would you try to escape?
Well, I shouldn't do anything at all risky. I might fly my shirt from one of the trees or something to try and attract attention. But I don't think I should try to go off on a raft or anything, because I'm sure I should be drowned if I did that.
Let's have record number 7.
That is Darius Milhaud's Création du Monde, which rather follows up the 20s line of thought. And I think brings back that period very much, with the general noise and the curious mixture of cynicism and yet enjoyment, which I think very much characterized that period.
Darius Milhaud conducting his own The Creation of the World. And now, your last record, what's that?
Well, the final one is from Debussy's Iberia, which I think would be for rather gloomy moods on the island. It's got a wonderfully bleak side to it.
Part of Debussy's Iberia, Ernest Ansemer conducting the orchestra of the Suisse Romande. If you could take just one disc of your eight, which would it be?
Well, I think I would have Lambert's Rio Grande, which I think would have most of the characteristics which I like, showing up.
And one luxury to take with you?
Well, my luxury would be a bottle of wine every day, of red wine, and I would drink a third of it at lunchtime, and two-thirds at dinner.
We will arrange enough for you to cover the length of your sojourn.
That'd be very kind. I don't mind perfectly ordinary rough red wine.
Well, not too rough.
Well, no, not too rough, because to recall Constant Lambert again, I remember he and I once bought a bottle of wine called Tawny Wine Port Flavour one afternoon. And it is one of the few bottles of wine I have been unable to drink. I think there are only two others, as far as I can remember.
And one book, apart from the Bible, Shakespeare, and big encyclopedias.
Yes, well, I should like A Hero of Our Time by Mikhail Lermontov, which, although it's quite a short book, has an extraordinary number of facets to it. And I think that if I had the Bible and Shakespeare to ponder over all the time, I should always be finding new things also in Lermontov's book.
A Hero of Our Time by Mikhail Lermontov. And thank you, Anthony Pearl, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you.
Goodbye, everyone.
You've been listening to a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For more podcasts, please visit bbc.co.uk/radio4.